Okay, well, thank you for being here this morning. Huge thank you to Yanis and Hélène, who gave Carmen and I the opportunity to talk about our work and the kind of topic that interests us. So my name is Régine Debaty. I'm an art critic and a blogger, and I curated with Carmen the exhibition See Blindness. I don't really like to talk about myself, so I'm going to go ahead and talk about the topic of the day. Is an interest I've had for something like 10 years to look at the clash between two dynamic processes that are changing the world, also changing the way we imagine the future of the world. And so these two dynamic processes are, on the one hand, the exponential rise of the power and implementation of technology, and in particular artificial intelligence, and on the other hand, the rapid degradation of the environmental conditions. And if you listen to some politicians or some people in the Silicon Valley, they will say that one is going to save the other, thus that in particular technology is going to protect us from the worst effects of climate change. And indeed, you see all these feel-good stories in the news where someone invented these machines that extract CO2 from the air and then buried it down into the ground. Or you read about techniques that have been developed to modify weather patterns, either temporarily or for a bit more long term, in order to cool down the planet. And then you have face recognition technologies or AI applications, which, as they say, are going to save the Amazon or save wildlife. And you can see why this kind of stories would make people happy, because on the one hand, they tell you you can continue living as you want, and at the same time, we are going all together to save the world. And there's an added bonus to this kind of techno solution, is that it means that you don't have to engage in difficult conversations such as, should we really continue to dream about eternal growth of the economy, or what is the role of capitalism in climate change? And you know, I cannot predict the future, but I imagine that at the next COP28, which is under the presidency of the managing director and group CEO of the Abu Dhabi National Oil Company, I imagine that this kind of techno fix and techno solution and greenwashing are going to be the star of the discussion. And while working on this presentation, I found this quote by Jacques Ellul. I don't know why he's not more famous. He was a philosopher, a sociologist, a theologian, and he called himself a Christian anarchist. And he wrote, modern technology has become a total phenomenon for civilization, the defining force of a new social order in which efficiency is no longer an option, but a necessity imposed on all human activity. So that's from 1954, but you can, you know, you could change modern technology and replace it by innovation or AI. And the most interesting part, I think, is that today we are at a stage where we replace, impose on all human activity, we replace it with impose on all planetary activities. So that's how totalitarian the role of technology has become in the mind of some people. But of course, technology doesn't exist in a vacuum. It has some really tangible physical consequences. It also has some humanitarian cost. And of course, to develop these technologies, whether it's AI or electric car, you need processes, you need materials, and you need whole industries that have a big carbon footprint. And now people like our friend here, Jeff Bezos, who is questioning a wind turbine farm, are going to tell you, oh yeah, but now we are using only clean energy and net zero and blah, 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 because the way we work is more and more efficient, and you know, our data centers are powered by green energy. But we've known, at least we've known it since the 19th century, that any gain in efficiency actually has what is called a rebound effect. And we know that we've known it since the British economist William Stanley Jevons wrote a book in which he was looking at the supply of coal in Great Britain, and he could see that the supply of coal under the ground was really diminishing. And he looked also at the fact that the machines were becoming more and more efficient, and so they needed less coal, and yet the demand for coal and iron and other materials continued to rise. So he thought it's quite counterintuitive. And in reality, you know, when a machine becomes more efficient and it needs less coal, the entrepreneur and the engineers or the inventors, they just invent more machines or create more ways to use the machines. And that of course, that drives the demand up. And if we bring that theory and that rebound effect to today, we can see that, yes, the data centers are becoming more efficient, but we are also generating and using and archiving more and more data. So it's kind of a race that has no end. So far I've been trying to explain how technology is trying to take control and redominate the effects of climate change. But I would like to, I mean, I've been looking at the way the opposite is happening and how climate change is actually disrupting technology. And as a first example of that was this study done a few years ago that was looking at densely populated coastal areas in the US. And they realized that when the sea level is going to rise, a number of internet, like crucial, critical internet infrastructure are going to be submerged by the water. And the problem is that, you know, the fiber optic cables that are crisscrossing the ocean to enable internet communication, they are waterproof, but the ones that are buried under the ground are not waterproof simply because they were laid 20, 25 years ago, and when no one was talking about climate change. And so they identified cities like Seattle, Miami, and New York are going to have their part of the internet infrastructure inundated. And of course, it would have effects on the rest of the territory. Another, like quickly, a few other examples. A couple of years ago, there was some really, really severe drought in Taiwan. So the government decided to impose restrictions on the supply of water, and the chipmaker industry started to order water by the truckload, which of course created problems for the farmers who needed that same water. You see the problem repeating over and over. Pretty much all over the world. I found it quite scandalous. It's this huge data center that has been approved for construction. This is in Spain near Toledo. And it was approved in May 2023, so just after Spain had experienced its driest April ever. There's been also debates in Ireland where, in order to meet its climate, its emission target, the government is thinking of culling up to 200,000 cows. And people say, yes, we may have a lot of cows in Ireland, but we also have far too many data centers, so why don't you cull the data center and let the cows live? So I could give more and more examples, but what I think this protest show is that technology should become part of the democratic discourse, and there are several ways that could be done. I mean, I don't have the recipe, but I guess by involving smaller actors, by informing better citizens, and I think it's not super easy because those who have the big budget for communication and advertising are usually not the NGOs or the cultural centers or even the government, it's the tech companies. And it's also important to allow or give space to citizens to make an informed choice about what they want about their future. Should we use more technology? Should we protect more the environment? And it sounds complicated, but last month in Ecuador, there was a referendum where they asked people about, like, should we choose the economy or the ecology? And people had to choose between accepting more drilling in the Amazonia or keeping this area protected, and they voted to protect the Amazonia. So that can be done. Unfortunately, that's not the way decision makers work, because science and technologies, they are really big instruments in the fight, or in the way they present the fight against climate change, simply because you know, it's reassuring, it allows them not to make difficult decisions. And there was a big scandal 3 years ago when there were debates and protests against the implementation of 5G in France, including engineers and designers said, do we really need 5Gs? And Emmanuel Macron, I mean, I've been quoting Jacques Ellul, and so here is another great French thinker, Emmanuel Macron, who said, I hear a lot of voices being raised to explain to us that the complexity of contemporary problems should be addressed by going back to the oil lamp. I don't believe that the Amish model can solve the challenges of contemporary ecology. And I think calling people Amish is a way to cut the debate and really to stigmatize people and say, well, you know, you are retrograde, you are Amish, or you are eco-terrorist, or you are the Reds, or you are the Green Ayatollah, and then prevent any debate to happen. I'm going to cut. So that's the first part, and the second part, I want to talk about a few artistic projects and how artists are imagining other ways to produce technology, but ways that are less predatory, that are more horizontal, more respectful of human beings and of territories. And of course, making technology is complicated. There is the mining, the refining, the assembling, the transporting. I decided to focus on mining for several reasons. One, it's that some of the critical minerals that we need for the so-called green transition are already, I mean, they're still there. It's just that it's getting more and more expensive and energy intensive to exploit them, and also because the EU wants to cut its dependency on China, and so they have this new policy where they want to mine more of their minerals in Europe, which is going, I think, to lead to more protests, and it's already happening. This is in Cáceres in Spain, where people are protesting against a project for a mine. So the first project is the Tiny Mining. Tiny Mining is an open community of artists, geologists, chemists, and also practitioners of alternative medicines. And they see the human body as a kind of repository for minerals that we could mine, because we have all kinds of minerals and metals in our body, some natural, other less natural. So for example, we have blood in our iron in our blood, some have kidney stones, my teeth are full of metallic fillings, some people take zinc for the energy. I read about people microdosing on lithium, and of course people have for hip replacement theory, they have titanium, and then there are all the metal particles that we inhale. So the Tiny Mining community shares tutorials online explaining you how you can mine metals from your own body. It starts by adopting what they call a very rich diet, where you eat beetroot, raw fish, oyster mushrooms, citrus fruit, dark chocolate to boost your level of minerals. And then you have a process called chelation or chelation, I never know how to pronounce it, where it's a process where you take, if you want to do it the soft way, you eat a lot of garlic, coriander, and onions, or you can take some specific medicine that will draw the minerals from your tissues and make it ready to be extracted. And then you make some tests to see if you have high levels of, I don't know, zinc or arsenic in your body. And then you're going to extract the minerals, and you're doing by urinating or by sweating. And I really like this project because it kind of repositions the body in codependency with the rest of the planet, and in particular with the non-living elements on this planet. The second project, I have only a few, so I'm almost there. The second project takes place in the Rio Tinto. So it's a region, it's also a river, and it's actually very, very red. It looks like the surface of Mars over there. It's a region which has a very, very long history of mining. And the color is red because there are particles of iron in suspension. So it's a very acidic river. It has very little oxygen, there's very little biodiversity. And the artist Cecilia Johnson went there, and so she noticed that there was only this plant, thriving in by the Rio Tinto. So the plant is called Imperata cylindrica, and it's considered a very aggressive, invasive plant. So people don't like it. But then the artist was reminded of a quote by the American poet Ralph Waldo Emerson that said, "What is a weed? A plant whose virtues have not yet been discovered." And the virtue of the Imperata cylindrica is that it is what is called a hyper-accumulator. And so hyper-accumulating plants are the plants that they literally drink up water, but also metallic particles from the soil, and store it in their roots, in their stems, in their leaves, until they wilt, and then the minerals and the metals go back in the soil. So what she did, she harvested 24 kilos of that Imperata cylindrica with rich iron content, and brought it, I think her residency was at V2 in the Netherlands, and then cleaned it and worked with goldsmiths, blacksmiths, with craftsmen, but also with industrial process to extract the iron from those plants and make an iron ring. So this is the iron ring. It's so out of 24 kilos of plant, she made this ring of 2 grams of iron. And of course, it's very poetical, but she imagines what mining could become like in a post-industrial world, where instead of, you know, harming the environment, you develop processes that allows you to mine for the minerals, the metals that you need, while healing the landscape. So it's a process called phytoremediation. And just for the quote, because he was a pioneer, I need to say something about Melchin, who was, I think, the first to develop these gardens where he planted garden in very polluted, contaminated soil, and he planted gardens of hyperaccumulators. He collaborated with scientists, and I think he was the first to do that. So a work by Quentin Destieux and Sylvain Huguet, who made these really primitive and rudimentary tools, and they made it by using e-waste of computers and phone. So they recovered all the metallic elements of e-waste, and using ancient technique, they melted the metals, and they made this kind of anachronistic weapons. And I think it's a really interesting project for several reasons. One is because it's reducing really the technology to its raw material, and so kind of negating this idea we have that digital technology is immaterial. And it's also showing that, you know, we used to have know-how of how to make weapons, or anyway, instruments in the past that we can still reproduce, whereas the instruments that we use every day now, we don't know how they work, we wouldn't be able to make them. And even if we were able to, by the time we've crafted them and learned how to make them, they would become obsolete, and with it, our knowledge would be obsolete. This is the last project. You probably heard about Agbo Bloshi. It's in Ghana. It was heavily advertised as the place where your device go to die, the most polluted place in the world. And you have, this is a photo by Peter Hugo. You have all these young people who are dismantling electronics and electrics and in really toxic conditions. And there's a kind of exploitation of this image and this aesthetic of suffering in Africa. But the story is actually a bit more interesting and complicated. So the Agbo Bloshi scrapyard is actually a very well organized space where people have divided the tasks. So some people are recovering the plastic and dividing several types of plastics. Other people are trying to recover specific elements, others only the metal. It's a form of urban mining. Others are trying to see if they can repair computers. So they are also kind of hackers. They can dismantle a computer but give it a new life. And then, you know, some are using parts of, I don't know, a fridge and repurposing it in, I don't know, in a fan or in a television. So they create this second life and this second economy for objects that for us are obsolete and that for us are trash. As I say, it's urban mining for metal. And I was really interested for a number of years in this project by Dike Oziwazare and Yasmin Abbas, who went there and they make these modular workshops, they call it makerspace, using only materials they found in the scrapyard and elsewhere in Ghana, where there are tools that people can use to develop less polluting way to extract plastic or copper from the wire, etc. But there's also another component that I like a lot, is that in Agbogbloshie, there were these people having these makers having this fantastic know-how, and they were learning by doing. And it's exactly the opposite of, you know, people who go to the university and learn engineering or mathematics, and their knowledge is very theoretical. So they are both architects, Oziwazare and Abbas. They organize this meeting between the makers and between the young professionals or the students to exchange, you know, knowledge and ideas on how to work better at Agbogbloshie. Unfortunately, Agbogbloshie got really too much press in Europe and in the US. At some point, the local government decided to destroy the place. So Agbogbloshie is still there, but it's just there are other activities now. And all the activity of dismantling and giving new life to electronics and to electric, it's been moved mostly in the house of the people, so they work in worse condition because they don't really have any space. Yes, and I love this project for several reasons. One of them is that it shows that Africa is something else than just a place where you have cheap labor and a lot of resources. It's also a place where you can learn a lot from and that has resources and ingenuity. And I love it because it pays homage to the people who take care of our trash, just like one of my favorite performances in the world is this one by Mirle Lerdermann-Ukeles, who in 1979, she started this really long process of working physically, doing shifts with the people from the sanitation department in New York City. So during eight months, she worked every single day with, not every single day, she had the weekends free, of course, but 8 hours a day with them. And she had this kind of rituals where she would thank every single person employed at the sanitation department of New York City and say, thank you for keeping New York City alive. And there were 8,500 people. She just shook hands with them and said, thank you for keeping New York alive. And I think all the artists have shown, each in their own way, they contribute to keeping us and the planet alive. And that's it.